so this week we are going to be on the second part of the seven C's of history. Now, last week I gave y'all this chart, and we were filling it in. All right, so on this chart, you've got creation, corruption, catastrophe, confusion, and then we had other C's. And then we've got Christ, cross, and the consummation. And we made it to Christ. We made it to Christ, and I kind of got in the middle of Christ, and I cut off. And I told y'all last week about Christ, the variation of the dates where they date Christ's birth. I told y'all my opinion. I usually go from 1 AD. You get a variation of those dates just because they're lining it up with Herod. Because Herod's got to be alive. You know, he sends the soldiers to kill the children in Bethlehem, things like that. So they know that he lived in approximate time. Jesus can't be born after that. So that's why they usually give that time frame. In Galatians, I went over this week, but I want to make it another point again, because this is a huge verse. We usually read over this and we don't grasp everything that it says. But when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his son made of a woman. And I read for y'all the very first a messianic prophecy last week of Genesis 3:15. Again, it says seed of a woman. That's going to be talking about the Messiah to come, made under the law to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. Now, this fullness of time, I kind of wanted to go a little bit deeper with it, and we're going to go even deeper when we get to this particular C. But when you look at everything going on in the world at the time that Christ is born, there's so much. I'm going to give you like the verses and the details later. I'm just going to kind of sum it up right now. Right at the time Jesus was born, I don't know if y'all know this, because it doesn't really say it in the Bible, but we know it through history, that Herod is actually made and given the title King of the Jews. He's not even Jewish. Yet the Romans give him, the Caesar give him that title. What does the Bible say? Y'all remember in the Old Testament about that verse where it says, the scepter shall not pass from... Can you fill it in? Who wants a sticker?
I don't know.
It's Judah, where he's given that, prediction to David. The scepter shall not pass from Judah. It's going to be that certain line that's going to be on the throne, and then we, you know, it's going to be through Judah. It's going to be through David's line. It's got to be specific to that line. Well, right at the time Herod is made king of the Jews, guess who's born? The true King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And we don't always grasp that when we're going through, you know, scripture, because we don't have history alongside with it. But it makes a lot of sense when you start researching, because isn't that just like God? You know what? You think you're going to make this guy the king? He's not even Jewish. This is the real king right here. But one of the things God did, he's orchestrated those 4,000 years of history, those other C's that we went over last week. But historically, it's the right time. Politically, it's the right time. Geographically, it's the right place. I don't know if y'all know this, but Israel, right where it sits, it's called the navel of the world. The navel of the world. Right there on that little strip of land, you're surrounded by the three main continents of the day. You've got Europe, you've got Asia, you've got Africa. If you are going to start something like a religion, where do you want it to start? Right there, where all those little embers of the wildfire can spread, is still strategic. Prophetically, it's time for the Messiah. We're going to go over that. Of how even the Jews of the day, they are looking for the Messiah. It's just they weren't expecting him to be that suffering servant, that baby in a lowly manger. They thought he was going to come back as the King of Kings, that valiant warrior who was going to deliver them from Rome. This was during a time of peace, somewhat. And they were trying to, Rome was trying to have peace over all of the area that they had. We're going to go over that. The roads. Hey, y'all drive down the road this morning. How many potholes did y'all see? The Romans had better roads than us. And they had them back in Jesus' day. And you know, some of them are still there. Yeah. Yeah. So roads, they had a road system. They were considered fairly safe for the time. Language. If you knew two languages, you could go all the way up to Northern Europe or down to Africa. The trade languages, which is why we have the New Testament written in Greek. All right, so people are hungry for the Messiah because they're under Roman rule. They're looking. When things go bad, what do? We start looking. Yeah, things going bad. You turn on your news, you see this. What do you start doing? Oh, we've heard about this before. We know the Lord's going to come back. We look for those things. Vast empire under one rule. You know what? If everybody's under one rule, it's easy to change things, isn't it? Yeah, because I can go into this country. I can go into this country. You know, it's separated now. There's a lot of little bitty countries through there. But if one kingdom is over all that, I can cross borders easier. And then lastly, culturally. While Rome conquers militarily, Greece before Rome conquered culturally. And Greek philosophy, boy, it sounds good, but it's empty. That's when we have the gospel. So there's a lot of things that we can look at as the fullness of time. You know, we can't just, fullness of time's four words, but we just went over a whole list of everything that made it the perfect moment. And we got to keep in mind too, this is the only kingdom of its day that's doing crucifixion. And crucifixion is one of those messianic prophecies back in Psalm 22. If you read that, it's talking about crucifixion. And crucifixion hadn't even been invented yet. It's going to be like 500 years later when you have the first crucifixion. So how can David write about crucifixion if it doesn't even exist yet? That's got to be straight from the Lord. This is Genesis 3:15. I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. Because if Jesus had been born of man, he would have had that sin curse. He couldn't have been our perfect sacrifice on that cross to take away the sins of the world. It would not have happened. If you study Old Testament sacrifices, that lamb had to be without blemish. That would have never happened. Let me give you this pop quiz. Let's see what you have to say about this. Now think about Jesus. Get your hands out. Jesus, being born of woman, he was fully human, yet fully God. If he had never went to the cross willingly and gave his life, would he have died? Does it make you think that?
Would he have died? I think he was part human. He would have died.
If he hadn't been of the flesh.
Because of the body.
He may not have died.
Would Adam and Eve have died if they hadn't sinned?
No.
Okay, would Jesus die because he hadn't sinned?
No.
I know, but he was in a sinful world at that time. I know he was God, but he has a human part.
He was aging. Was he?
You said he was aging.
Well, I'm not.
Yeah.
Aging.
He was aging because he went from baby to 33.
So he has that human aspect, even though he is God. That human part's going to die.
So yeah. You think he would die?
I think he would. What's the right answer?
Yeah, I don't know that you can nail it down. I'm asking.
So you got a sticker either way.
I'm just giving that to you to make you think. I'm thinking of it from the deity perspective because he's not born of man. I'm thinking he had to give his life.
He had to, but even if he hadn't, he was still going to die, I think, on the human aspect.
Jason.
Unless he decided not to.
Or he could have walked with God.
He could have walked with God. I'm just giving you something to think about. That was my question when I was reading through like a couple years ago. And I came and I asked Keith, and he was like, don't do this to me. No, we talked about it for like an hour, and I don't think you can answer that 100%. I don't think.
Yeah.
So y'all think about it. Let me know next week.
But like you said, that doesn't matter because he had to die anyway.
He did.
So that is, it doesn't mean anything. Why don't we talk about it?
But the verse where he is on the cross and it says he gave up the ghost.
Right.
He gave up the ghost. It's kind of.
You think he chose when he was going to die, since it said he gave up the ghost?
Yes.
It's like, okay, I'm seeing
it. And I think it was specific because, okay, the Paschal lamb was sacrificed at a specific time in the temple. And that lamb, without blemish, had to be within this certain window during Passover. And I think that it had, like, Jesus had to be within that certain window as well. So I think it was very specific. The exact moment was specific. So, yes, I think it was purposeful. If God can orchestrate this 4,000 years of history, yes, he's got it down to the second. You know, he can do that. We talked about last week, he's outside of time. He knows how to orchestrate everything.
I think our life is like that too.
Yes.
Where's Christ,
yes.
He's orchestrated everything.
And then
he knows what's coming. It's like, I mean, you know,
absolutely.
He knows what tomorrow holds.
Absolutely.
And another thing, if you think about this, and we're going to go over this in a little bit more detail about Herod. I don't know how much y'all know about Herod historically, but he was insane. He really was insane. He killed his children so they wouldn't take his throne. He killed his wife. It was horrible. And when he killed his wife, he kept her body and talked to her like she was still there. It was. He was crazy. And then you think, why in the world would God let somebody like that even be in charge? But don't we ask ourselves that today,
right,
too? You know, we
I'm
look
Biden
at...
Biden president. Yes, he does.
And we know
yes,
that
does.
From the book of Daniel.
Yeah.
God sets up kingdoms. He sets up kings. And we don't always understand why he does what he does. But Herod being in that position accomplished God's goal. And we're going to talk about that in more detail too, because we're looking at it from a human perspective and we're saying, this makes no sense to me. Why would God do this? Because if I was in charge, I would do this, or I would set this person up for da-da-da.
That's why you're not in charge.
That's why I'm not in charge. Right. Now, Matthew 1, 18 and 19. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with the child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being just a man, and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. We're going to go over this in a little bit more detail, too. The original name... Y'all, the letter J was not even invented until the 14th century. So, it's not the Jesus sound when we're talking about his name. Yeshua. But that will take us back to someone in the Old Testament. Joshua. And Jesus and Joshua have a lot in common. And I don't think that's by mistake. You know, we have a lot of typologies in the Old Testament that point to Jesus in the New Testament. Let me give you the last two verses. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. He came to be with us and for a purpose. But I want you to think about this. He was only here a short time. We're not at the consummation yet, that last C on the timeline. So when we're talking about, you know, this, it, his name means God with us. We've got to go through him to have the fulfillment of God with us in eternity. We've got to make that choice because that was God's goal from the very beginning. You know, I've told y'all before, I've been doing the youth here for 10 years, and I get three main questions. Where'd I come from? Why am I here? And where am I going? That takes you to Genesis and Revelation. That's what the majority of my questions. And this explains all of it. When we dig into these seven C's, it gives us that. So now let's go on to the cross. If you have your papers, the cross, of course, is going to be about 33 AD. Where the first Adam brought death through sin, Christ brings us life through his righteous life. You're going to see that term several times, the second Adam. Adam, number one, is a typology to Jesus Christ as well. So we're going to break that down as we go through. What the first Adam failed at, the second Adam, Jesus is going to fulfill. He's going to live that sinless life. And I told y'all last week about how when Adam and Eve sinned, how God killed that first sacrifice, that first blood sacrifice, and Adam and Eve had to wear it, and how that pointed to the cross. And what happened on that cross, what do? When we ask for salvation, we're asking Jesus to cover us. That's what we want. We want that spiritual covering. Colossians 1:19 and 20. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. And you who once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him. And the thing is about the cross, there's so much information on the cross. You know, we have details in God's word. John gives us a lot of details about being right at the cross. If y'all remember when the spear went in and what came out? Do you remember? It was blood mixed with water. And we can trace that back to medical terminology. I'm not going to go over it this morning, but they know exactly what was going on in Jesus' body. From the beating, from the crown of thorns, from being on that cross, medically what is happening inside his body for that detail of blood and water. Let me take you back to just Jesus' birth. Luke, being a physician, writing about the virgin birth, that's huge. You know, if it was John or if it was Matthew, yeah, that's good. But Luke, being a professional doctor at his time, if a doctor's telling you that this is a virgin birth, do you see how that speaks more of his qualifications? And he's very detailed in his writing. He gives you a lot of countries, a lot of cities, a lot of people who are in power at that time, the leaders of the day, and he's making great effort to give you the details. And that speaks hugely about how he wrote, very, very detailed. So let me give you the consummation. So the consummation is the one we don't have a date. Everything else has a date, but not the consummation. Can somebody tell me what do you look forward to at the consummation? What's it going to be like when we stand before God? Can Can you imagine a world with no sin? No pain? No growing old? No tears? We can't imagine it because all we've known is this sinful world. I don't think we can fathom it. And when we think about heaven, what's it going to be like? We know during the millennial reign, the millennial reign is going to take us back to somewhat of an Eden-like environment. There will be still a remnant of natural man. They're going to have children and for 1,000 years or whatnot. But if we are saved, the rapture's got to take place first. So that all those who are raptured that are the bride of Christ, you're in your glorified body. When we go into the millennial reign, we're going to be coming back with Christ. We're going to break down the rapture. We're going to break down heaven and hell. And we're going to break down eternity and what comes with eternity. Revelation 21 verses 1 through 2. I was giving y'all a verse last week and I said eternity was this way past Genesis 1:1, and I said Revelation 19:5. I was like two chapters off because it's got to be chapter 21 until we get into eternity. So I was off on my chapters going up. I shouldn't go off the top of my head. But Revelation 21, 1 and 2, then I saw a new heaven and new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. I heard, this was maybe a year ago now, and I think it was David Jeremiah, and he was quoting Henry Morris. And I don't know if y'all know who Henry Morris is. He's like, they call him the father of creationism. He was very well versed in creation apologetics. And he says, you know, out in California, he's like, how many of y'all like the ocean? And of course, like his congregation, it's a video of him like on a Sunday morning or something, and they all raise their hand, and he is, well, you're not going to have that in the new heaven and the new earth. And he was like, you think that's sad, but it's not. And he says, think about it this way. He says, the ocean right now is part of our natural water cycle, right? Natural water cycle. We've got to have that evaporation to come and get in the clouds and come on land, and then it rains, and then it goes back to the ocean. You've got to have that. He was like, the new heavens and the new earth are not going to be governed by natural law. He said, think about it. Who's going to be the light? Does it say we're going to have like a sun, moon, and all that? No, it says that the Lord's going to be the light. So this is going to be something supernatural. And then he says, but salt in the ocean is a preservative. He said, there's going to be no decay. So that we're not going to even have a need for salt. And I was like, that's a pretty good explanation. I mean, we know we're going to have water. You know, there is water described and things like that, but not a sea. The sea was no more. And it said, and I saw a holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as the bride adorned for her husband. And I told y'all a couple weeks ago that if you go to the last verse of Ezekiel, it will give you the name of the New Jerusalem. The literal name of the New Jerusalem is Jehovah Shammah. The Lord is there. That's going to be the ultimate consummation. The Lord is going to be there. We are going to be with Him. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. And He will dwell with them, and they will be His people, and God Himself will be with them as their God. I'm going to pause again right here. Do you realize that when God led Moses and all of the people out of the Exodus, 40 years in the wilderness, when they come through and they go and conquer the promised land, God, creator of the universe, who can speak things into existence, loved His people so much, He was willing to dwell in a tent. He could have spoke anything into existence, but He was he was willing to dwell in a tent. And if you remember David, he's in his palace one day and he was like, you know what, I live in this and God's still dwelling in the tent. I want to build him a house. And that's how he comes about, you know, getting plans for the temple and everything like that. Verse 4, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and the death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain any more, for the former things have passed away. We're not bound by nature's laws any more. No sin, no aging, nothing that can hurt you. This is what God wanted with the first sea, with creation. This is what he wanted. He wanted to be able to have a relationship with us. So the application of this, how do you see this framework being helpful as you interact with people in your life? I think this is going to come in handy, especially like Courtney, you having children. They're going to come home with questions because what they're going to be taught in school is going to be different from what they're taught when they come to church. And we have a lot of kids who grow up and they separate those. Well, this is science and this is my faith and they can't put them together. These lessons that we're going to go over is going to show you you can put them together. You don't have to give up your education to have your faith and vice versa. Because we can take God at his word, just like I've told y'all with dinosaurs. Anywhere you go, pretty much you're going to be taught dinosaurs are millions and millions of years old. I mean, just the way it is. We dig up their bones. How can we argue against that? Well, there's plenty of evidence that we're never taught in school. I mean, they just found one back in 2005. 2005, where there's still ligaments, red blood cells, where you can see like an entire joint. How does that work if that's millions of years old? That should be ash in the wind, you know? So I think when we're going through this, it's going to show you of God's plan. It's going to show you details of how God did create. And that way you can interact, I mean, grandkids, kids. But it's also a faith builder for us, too. You know, I remember being in the eighth grade, and I think that was the year it was really pushed with us, the creation, I mean, not the creation, the Big Bang. And I remember opening up the textbook, and it had that picture from the monkey to the man in there. And, hey, you got to pass your test, right? You got to write down the answers or you're gonna fail. And if you would have asked eighth grade Ashley, what do you believe? I would have told you I believe God's word. But if you would have asked me why, I wouldn't have had the answer other than, I just do. That's God's word. Is that enough? Yes. That's just simple faith. Yes, it is enough. But if you ask me today, I can go back to the principles of these seven C's and I can explain my answer, whereas eighth grade Ashley could not. Does that make sense, what I'm saying? So I think that's why it's important. Another thing I wanted y'all to see is this chart. So we went over like timeline of 6,000 years last week. Scott bought me this chart a few years ago, but it's got all of the Bible, the major events of the Bible, all the way up to 2014 where you can see it in a timeline. I want y'all to look at that, like glance at it before you leave. And I guess that is all that I have. Y'all have any questions? I'll see y'all next week.
I didn't have any kids.